Good morning, everyone. All right, good morning, everyone. Hey. All right, so to get us started, let's bow our heads in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this beautiful day that you've blessed us with. Thank you for all of the other blessings that you have poured upon us, God, and all of the ones that are to come. Please help us live for you today, God, and today, as Mr. Cole speaks to us about you, help us to listen with our hearts open, our minds open, and just learn about you, God. In your most glorious name, I pray. Amen. And right now, if you guys would turn your attention to the video that we're about to play.
Let's look at Romans 8:15. So if you have not received a spirit that makes you fearful, slaves. Let me pause here. What are you afraid of? Maybe you're afraid you're not pretty enough. Maybe you're afraid you're not smart enough. Maybe you're afraid that you can't overcome that particular sin habit. Maybe you're afraid of dying. Maybe you're afraid that wayward son or daughter may never come home to Christ. We don't have to be afraid. Listen to this. Instead, you receive God's Spirit when He adopted you as His own children. Now we call Him Abba, Father. Not only does He adopt us and bring us into His family, it says that's what He wanted to do, and it gave Him great pleasure. If you're not yet a follower of Jesus, just marinate. Followers of Christ, I want you to engage this. I think for many of you, you go, I know God loves me, but does He like me? Does God really like me? And one of the reasons why we think that is because we think that God loves us in the first place based on what we do or don't do. So we need to stop that faulty theology, because God's love for you is based on what Christ and Christ alone has done. If you can do something to make God love you or like you more than He does now, then you eclipse what Jesus has done. And don't get it twisted. No one can eclipse what beautiful Jesus has done. God's affection for you is rooted in His affection for Jesus. And when you and I get that, you know what it does? It makes us passionate worshipers. It makes us adore Him. It makes us lose our everlasting mind. The brain circuits are blown away with the epicness of His grace. That's what happens. And it says He takes great pleasure in us. Zephaniah 3:17 says that God sings and dances over you. It's freaking you out right now, ain't it? God sings and dances over you because He sings and dances over His Son Jesus. And because you are in His Son Jesus, He sings and dances over you. And what's going to change your behavior is not looking at how jacked up you are, but looking at how great He is. Can I preach just for a minute? Would you behold Jesus? Would you just behold Him? Don't be a spiritual narcissist. Am I doing something right? Am I doing something wrong? Behold Jesus, and His glorious love through the Spirit's power will take care of all that. Behold Him. God is delighting and singing and dancing over you. Everything that you and I have can be taken away from us. Everything that you and I have can be taken away, except for this. You are a beloved daughter of the King. You are a beloved son of the King.
Father, Son, and Spirit, thank you that we no longer have to be afraid because we are sons and daughters of you, our King. Would you be with us today and help us to know your Son, the Prince of the Universe, better today? It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. By show of hands, raise your hand if you have come to the point in your life where you realize that things don't always work out exactly the way you wish they would. Okay, good. A couple of the sixth graders haven't quite figured it out yet, but they will. It's just a matter of time. So my family figured out that things don't always work out exactly according to plan many moons ago when I was a small child. So my family, we have a lot of traditions My brother is to thank for that. He loves traditions, actually. So we have all these different traditions, Halloween traditions, Easter traditions, Christmas. We have a ton of traditions we just went through. Went through is not the right word. That makes it sound like they're bad. They're fun. So Easter, the tradition when we were kids, we'd all go to my grandmother's house, and she always makes this coconut cake that's shaped like a rabbit head, the bunny cake. One year she tried to make cupcakes, and we were like, Mama, no, we're not eating no cupcakes on Easter. This is ridiculous. So she always makes this bunny cake, because I lost my freaking mind when she made cupcakes. Another one of the traditions is we always have an Easter egg hunt, because you got to hunt eggs on Easter, because that's how we celebrate Jesus rising from the dead. I don't know the connection, really, but that's what we do. We hunt Easter eggs. In my family, one of the Easter eggs, all of the Easter eggs are the plastic ones, right? They have candy in them, and then one of them has money in it, and that's the prize egg, and if you find that, then you win Easter. So me and my brother and my cousin, Dylan, that would be Katie Hammock's older brother. We're hunting Easter eggs, and the culmination of Easter, we have got coconut shavings stuck to our face from eating the coconut cake, and we gather our basket full of Easter eggs, and we go sit on, there's like this bunk bed in the back, we called it the playroom, there's a big toy chest back there. We went to the back room, and we get on the top bunk of the bunk bed, and we just go crazy eating all the candy in our Easter eggs, and then Easter is over. That's how we celebrate Easter, right? So that's when you find out who gets the prize egg, because you open it, and if there's candy, you eat it. If there's money, you put it in your pocket. That is how it ought to go. But like I said, sometimes plans don't exactly work out, and that's why my cousin is now worth like $1.25, because he was so young that he didn't realize that he got the prize egg, so he just ate the quarters. Not exactly how that was supposed to go. He opens it, and we're like, oh, sweet, you got the prize egg. And he's like, oh, that's awesome. I wish I hadn't got it. This tastes terrible. Eventually, he crapped out about 25 cents. But he is fond of saying that he will always be worth something, because apparently he, like, has to be careful when he gets x-rays and MRIs and stuff, because he's, like, got quarters still inside his body. Things don't always work out right. What I'd like to look at today is why in the world do things not always work out right? It seems like they ought to work out right. Right? Like we looked at last week that we are children of God. And if our Father is as good a Father as He says He is, and if He has as great a plan for our future as He promises He does in Scripture, why in the world is it that things don't always work out right? Why don't we realize the difference between real quarters and candy quarters? Why don't we realize the difference? Why don't we realize the real true value of the prize egg and hold on to that and treasure that money that we've been given? Why instead do we eat the quarters? Right? Things don't always work out right, and that doesn't make any sense, because God promised that He loves us and He has a good plan for us, and in the meantime, things are going wrong. Things aren't always going right. That makes no sense. So that's what I'd like for us to look at today. If you would look with me at Genesis chapter 1, verse 27. I'm sure everyone's familiar with this verse. So God created man in His own image. In the image of God, He created him. Male and female, He created them. Let's pray. Father God, thank You for being our Father, and for having made us in Your image. I pray that You would help us to grasp the true meaning of Your image, that we might live up to the inheritance You've given us, and we look forward to the culmination of that inheritance when Your Son returns, and we can worship Him in flesh as well as in spirit and truth. It's in His name we pray. Amen. So it says that God made us in His image, and everybody kind of have heard that before, right? You know, we are made in the image of God, and there's lots of discussion about exactly what does that mean. I've heard it described in lots of different ways. The most fun way I've heard it described, well, I guess there are two ways that it kind of helped me understand. To be made in God's image means that we share some characteristics of God. So in a physical sense, I am made in the image of Robert Cole. So if you know my dad, I have some of the same personality traits and some of the same characteristics. I also have some different personality traits and characteristics. Some of the same facial features I share with my dad, some of them I share with my mom because I was made in the image of my mom and my dad. Right? Makes sense? We have some things in common with our parents. An illustration that I like to help people understand what does it mean to be made in the image of God. Have you ever opened a brand new can of Play-Doh, like for the first time? You know what I'm talking about? And it's like a little cylinder, and the cylinder is a little bit smaller. And so, like, if you shake it, you can tell if it's a new or an old can of Play-Doh, because if you shake it, the new one rattles. Y'all know what I'm talking about? What's the very first thing you do when you open the can of Play-Doh? Somebody said it. You smell it, because it smells awesome. I don't understand it. I can't explain why Play-Doh smells so awesome, but it does. Did you know the smell of Play-Doh is actually copyrighted? That blows my mind. Okay, so you open it up. Oh, it's Play-Doh time. So then you pour the Play-Doh out in your hand, and then what's the second thing you do? You squish it. Everybody knows this. You squeeze it. And if you do it just right, it squirts out in between your fingers, and it feels awesome. That's how you know it's time to play with some Play-Doh, right? So you sniff the Play-Doh, and you take it out, and you squeeze it, then you open it up, and then it's like the exact opposite of your hand, right? You have made the Play-Doh in the image of your hand. That's what that means. Everything God created, he created by speaking it into existence, right? And on the first day, he said, let there be light. On the second day, he said, let there be a sky and an ocean. On the third day, he said, let there be earth. So on and so forth. Everything he speaks into existence until he gets almost done. He's created everything. And then on the last day, he doesn't speak us into existence. He doesn't speak Adam into existence. The only thing he made this way, he actually comes to earth, seemingly physically, and he kneels down in the clay, and he molds Adam with his own hands. Something different is happening when he makes us. This isn't some detached, like, let there be light. This is an intimate experience. He molds and crafts Adam with his own hands. And then it's just a sculpture. Good job, Jesus. You made a fancy dirt sculpture. Proud of you. Then he takes it to the next level, and it says that he actually breathes his life into Adam, into this dead clay, and that's how Adam comes alive, and that's our story. That's how we came to be here. The breath of God himself was breathed into us. And if you look almost every other time in the Old Testament, the breath of God is translated the Holy Spirit. That's our story. Is that we were molded by the hands of the Father himself and indwelt with the Holy Spirit from the very beginning. That's what it means to be a human being. That's who we are. So that's been crafted by the hands of the Father, indwelt with the Holy Spirit. That's been the story of what it means to be created in the image of God. For ever since that was written, ever since the book of Genesis was written. Does anybody notice anything missing in that story? Crafted by the hands of the Father and indwelt by the Holy Spirit, what's missing? I hear some people whispering. You guys are right. It's Jesus, right? If the Father's there and the Spirit is there, then Jesus has got to be involved. It only makes sense. And we find out, Paul tells us when he writes Colossians, let's turn on your phones to Colossians. Where am I at? Colossians chapter 1. Here's where we get a fuller picture of exactly what happened when we were created. It starts in Colossians 1:15. This is talking about Jesus here. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created by him and for him. So we're created in the image of God, right? The whole crafted by the hands of the Father and then breathed in by the Holy Spirit. Well, Colossians chapter 1, verse 15 says that Jesus is the image of God. So if we're created in the image of God, if Adam was created in the image of God, and Jesus Christ is the image of God, then Adam somehow, I don't claim to understand it, but Adam was created in Jesus. It says in there that everything that was made by Jesus, and I think more importantly, was made for Jesus. So Adam is created in Jesus, by Jesus, and for Jesus. Everything in this universe is about Jesus. It has always been about Jesus. And Jesus has always been about you because you are his beloved. You're the children of God. If Jesus is the Son of God and we are children of God, then in some ways Jesus is our older brother. He's the older brother of the human race. And he is all about us. So why in the world is it that things go wrong? Right? Why do we eat the quarters instead of put them in our pocket? I think the key is in Colossians chapter 1 when it says that everything was made for him. I think that what that means is that if we're going to compare the human being to a motor or an engine, God is the fuel that we were meant to burn. Jesus Christ is the fuel of the human engine. He is the food that we were meant to eat. And so what happens when you try to put water in an internal combustion engine? Anybody know? It doesn't exactly run very well, right? Or even if you put diesel in a gas engine, what happens? It'll start, but it definitely does not run properly. If you put gas in a diesel engine, gas burns a little hotter than diesel, and so when you turn the key off, it actually won't shut off, and it'll burn the engine up. It doesn't work right. If you have to have the exact right fuel for the exact right engine. You guys following me so far? That's why things don't always go right, because we try to burn the wrong fuel. That's what happened with Adam and Eve. They thought that they could run the human engine based on themselves. They thought that they were sufficient to be the fuel for their own engine. Why can't we be like gods? That's the whole point. God didn't punish them and kick them out of the garden because they ate fruit. He punished them and kicked them out of the garden because they thought that they could be gods. They thought that they could be the ones to fulfill themselves. And of course, that's ridiculous. And so it was a mercy. The tree of life is there in the Garden of Eden. If God continues to allow them to have access to the tree of life, then they're going to live forever and be forever miserable. And so he kicks them out of the garden so that they might die, so that through their death they might understand the emptiness of trying to fulfill their own selves and see the truth of who Jesus always has been, and that the tree of life isn't a tree at all. It's a person. It's Jesus Christ. Does that make sense? So why is it that things go crazy? Because of sin. Because we try to run our human engines on the wrong fuel. The only path to happiness, the only way anything can ever be right, is through God himself. You ever been fishing? And I think I've told you guys about this before, but when you catch a fish and you pull it up out of the water and you drop it down into the floorboard of the boat, what happens? What does the fish do? It flops around like crazy, right? Why does it do that? Why does the fish flop around like crazy? Because it was made for water, because it knows it. That's not where it belongs. Okay, if I were to fall into the lake, I would feel wet. If I drop the fish into the lake, it doesn't feel wet. It just feels like this is normal, right? I guess I'm dry right now, but I don't think about that all the time. Like, man, my skin is so dry. I'm not soaking wet at all. I never think about that because I was made to be dry. It's the opposite for a fish. It's made to be wet. It's made to be in the water. And so when you pull it up out of the water, I don't have to kick it and poke at it with my rod to tell it to flop around. It does that on its own because it knows that's not what it was made for. When we all heard that Lauren had passed away, nobody had to tell us to be sad. Nobody had to poke at us or punch us or hurt us in any other way to tell us that something is wrong and that's not right and that is terrible and I feel sad about it. Nobody had to tell us that. Why? Why does the fish flop around? Because it was made for water, and when you take it out of the water, it hurts. Why do we hurt? Because Lauren's not in this gym right now. Because we were made to be together, because we were made for life. We weren't made for separation. We weren't made for death. And so, of course, it hurts when we're rejected by someone. Why does that hurt? Because we were made, crafted by the hands of the Father in Jesus Christ and dwelt with the Holy Spirit for acceptance. So when we're rejected, of course it hurts. That's not what we were made for. When we try to run the fuel, we try to burn the wrong fuel in the human engine, of course things go wrong, because that's not what we were made for. There's a story of, I think, kind of an example of how this happens, and then we're almost done. In Matthew chapter 28, so the story is Jesus has been crucified, and he's been buried in the tomb, And Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Jesus, they want to go and kind of pay their respects. So they go to the tomb. And things don't exactly work out the way they planned them, thankfully. Matthew 28, verse 1. After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord come down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He is risen, just as he said." What these women were doing is what we do all the time. It's what I do every day of my life. And it doesn't make any sense. They were looking for the living, in fact, the creator and author of life itself, in a graveyard. He is not here. He is risen. Every time we sin, that's what we're doing. We're going to a graveyard looking for life. You can never, sinning, it never actually makes any sense, if you think about it. Because every time we sin, what we're doing is we're trying to find a good thing. Our goal is actually something that is really and truly good. Okay? So if I steal something from someone, what I'm trying to get might be security, financial security. Financial security is a good thing. Stealing is not. It's the wrong way to go about getting it. Or I might be trying to just pay for some food, right? That's a good thing. Food is a good thing. Stealing is not a good thing. Stealing is going about, the reason stealing is wrong is because I'm trying to get a good thing and I'm trying to go about getting it in the wrong way. That's what sin is, right? that's why sin never makes any sense. We're looking for something living. The Marys went to the tomb looking for Jesus. Jesus is what they ought to have been looking for. The problem was they were looking for it in the wrong place. And that's why they were disappointed at first. Because he wasn't there. He's not here. He is risen. So my challenge, I guess, to you guys is don't go to the tomb looking for life. He's not there. He is risen. If we're looking for life, if we're wondering why things hurt, it's because Jesus himself is the author and source of life. And so there's two reasons why things hurt. One is that we're looking for good things in the wrong way. We're going to the tomb looking for life, and it's not there. It's never been there. Or it's because Jesus hasn't come back yet. We're in the in-between time between the fall of Adam and Eve and the return of the true King of the universe, Jesus Christ. And so we weren't made for this world. Of course things are going to hurt. Of course things are going to go wrong. That's to be expected. And honestly, I think that is just simply proof that we weren't made for this world. Because if we were created to be rejected, rejection would feel awesome. Fish are created for water. That's why water feels awesome. We weren't created for all of this mess. That's why it hurts. And so I guess I would leave you with that. And I hope that is encouraging to you, that even when things hurt, even when things go wrong, that is only proof of the infinite love of God for us and proof that there is something better. And it will one day be here, and it will be here quickly. Let's pray. Father, thank you for making us with your own hands and for giving us your Spirit and your Son. I pray that you would help us to live righteously so that we might be, so that we might bear witness to the truth of your gospel to those who don't yet understand. I pray that you would help us to be patient in this in-between time while we wait for your Son to return and make everything that is broken fixed. He promised that he makes all things new. We are not yet new. And I pray that you would come quickly and make us new in this world that we live in. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. Would you stand and worship with us?
can't separate. Even if I ran away, your love never failed. I know I still make mistakes, but you have new mercy for me every day. Your love never fails.
Singer, you stay.
Can you hear me? Okay, there we go. All right, let's bow our heads and pray. Dear God, thank you so much for loving us unconditionally. Help us to love one another the way that you love us, God. Help us to live this day to glorify you, God, because that's all that matters, is glorifying you and praising you, God. In your most glorious name I pray. Amen. Miss Porter needs the volleyball team to stay after chapel, and everybody else is dismissed. Have a great day.